things to say was, today is the first day of the rest of your life. I may remember that. Everybody. Good. Well, today is the first day of the rest of the church year. The next time we change seasons, it'll be Advent. So if it seems long, there's a reason. And we start with three kind of interesting lessons. I am told that the lessons are not necessarily picked because they relate one to the other, but that they somehow relate to the season. I think I have found a little something they have in common, so we're going to work our way through them and then maybe tie them all together. So we're going to start with Elijah, good old Elijah. Elijah is dealing with a people who are suffering from a severe drought. They have prayed to God to take care of the drought. They've also had some dealings with Baal, just to cover the bases, you know, might help. And King Ahab, who is famous for being not a God-following kind of person, whose wife is the ever-famous Jezebel, has called all the people together, and Elijah has said to them, make up your mind. Kind of fish or cut bait. Are you going to follow God, or are you going to follow the Canaanite gods? There was no question about there being other gods. It was a question of, who's going to take care of this drought? Who's going to be kind of the head god? And so Elijah proposes a little competition. It involves a couple of bowls and a lot of wood. And he offers graciously to let the servants of Baal go first. They sacrifice their bull, they call on their god, Baal, and nothing happens. And Elijah's not especially gracious. He mocks them, to be really honest. And he says, well, you're obviously not trying hard enough. You're not saying something right. Something has gone wrong because Baal's not showing up, guys. Maybe he's taking a nap. And so they get more and more excited and they start damaging themselves. And finally they give it up. And then calmly, after all this frenetic behavior, calmly Elijah reassembles an altar with stones, 12, because there are 12 tribes of Israel. He puts the wood on top of the stones. He puts the parts of the bowl on top of the wood. And he digs a trench around the whole thing. And he digs the trench deep enough to hold 2 measures of seed. I have no idea how much that is. However, then, because he's a bit of a showman, he says, take 4 buckets of water, pour it on the wood. Now, that should make it hard to light. It makes it hard when I have damp wood in my wood-burning stove. So buckets of water, got to be a problem. So he has him do it again. And he has him do it a third time. So now everything is thoroughly drenched and the entire trench is full of water. And he's very simple in his prayer. Look at what he says. It's at the bottom of page 3 and the top of page 4. He says, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel. I am your servant and I have done these things at your bidding. Answer me so that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God and that you have turned their hearts back to me, him, you. That's all it took. The fire of God came pouring down, took care of the bowl, took care of the wood, took care of the rocks, and the water in the trench. Pretty impressive. Big surprise that all the people fell on their faces and said, the Lord indeed is God, the Lord indeed is God. Now I have to confess to you that I get a little smirky when I hear that last part. Because what always comes to mind for me is the cowardly lion in The Wizard of Oz who says, I do believe it's spooks, I do believe it's spooks, because it's that scary, right? So, Elijah has established that of all the gods, plural, our God is the most powerful and will take care of the drought in God's own time. So we move on to Galatians. If you've sat through any number of services, and most of you have, you have heard repeatedly different openings of different letters of Paul to the communities to whom he is writing. They almost always say, Paul, a description of him and the people who are with him, to the name of the church, and he always says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? And usually he goes on and says things like, I give thanks to you for God because you're so faithful and you're so generous, you're doing such good work. Well, did you notice that's absent? He is really annoyed with the Galatians. He has preached to them, and they have bailed. He is not amused. Somebody, one of the commentaries I wrote said, he is just this side of being so annoying that he wants to curse them. That's pretty strong language. It seems that the backstory is that there are people in Galatia, probably another Christian sect, who is saying Paul has watered down the Christian faith because he is saying that Gentiles don't have to follow all the laws of Torah to be a member of the Christian community and followers and lovers of God. They're accusing him of people-pleasing and making it too easy to become a Christian. The other people want them to, people to go through circumcision and obey all the laws and all that stuff, and that's part, they say, of what makes you a Christian besides following Jesus. So Paul is not only being challenged theologically, he is being challenged personally. And he is not taking it well. So he writes from that perspective. He says, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another gospel, mind you, but y'all aren't getting with the program. And he says, I am not a people pleaser. I did not make this up. I did not learn this from any human being. I didn't train in this from somebody that taught me from the human perspective. If I were people-pleasing, this is not what I would be saying. The implication is, I go back to being the Roman guy and start taking you out again. So he's like, this is not like my chosen vocation, I got called to this, and not by any human being. And if you doubt me, you're the one who's missing the boat. He ends by saying, rather emphatically, the gospel that was proclaimed by me is not of human origin, for I did not receive it from a human source, nor was I taught. But I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. You can't get much more direct from the source than that. And then we come to the gospel. And in the gospel we have a centurion, a Gentile, a Roman officer, sending Jewish elders to him. These elders come to ask for the healing of the centurion's servant. And they tell Jesus what a great guy this centurion is. He built our synagogue. He takes care of our people. This is not one of the Romans who is beating us up and ripping us off and raising our taxes. This guy likes us and he's taking good care of us, and please will you do this for him? So Jesus agrees to come forward and to go and see the servant to heal him. As he's getting closer to the centurion's house, the centurion sends friends out, we assume they're Gentile, and he says, please, don't come. You don't need to come. I know you don't need to come. I'm not worthy to have you in my house. I just know that you can heal him from where you are. You don't need to be troubled to come. Because I understand authority. I give orders to someone, and they do it. I say go here, they go. I say go there, they go. I say jump over this fence, they jump. He understands about Jesus' authority to heal. There's no question for him about, is it going to work, is it not going to work? The Jewish elders talk about what a humble man he has been, and he proves it himself by saying, don't come. Oh my gosh. That's way too much. Just healing and we'll get on with life. And Jesus says to the people around him, nowhere in Israel have I seen anyone with this kind of faith. Nowhere have I seen someone who absolutely just assumes it will happen because he has asked and I have said yes. That's astonishing. Remember, Gospel of John. John says, I have done these things so that you might believe. This is a man who doesn't even need to see that stuff. And coincidentally, it's the beginning of people who have not traveled with Jesus and walked with Jesus becoming devout followers and disciples, which is important because this is Luke's gospel, which is about 100 years after Jesus. So this is about people reading a story about somebody like them, somebody who wasn't there when Jesus was walking around doing stuff, but who still believed. And here's somebody who is a Gentile, who wasn't there, who has a faith so thorough that he just knows it's going to be done because he's asked. That's a word of really good news to people who are like, is it still true 100 years later? Is this still going to be true for me? And when the friends get home, of course, the servant is home. So, in all three of these lessons this morning, we have some approach to authority. Elijah is a little flashy, but he makes it clear who God is. Paul is claiming his authority. He's claiming to theologically and personally be the source for the gospel and the love of God. That when he says, it's simply by believing in the love of God and the sacrifice of Christ that you become a follower of Jesus and God. That receiving that grace is all it takes. You don't have to do all that law stuff. The centurion lives authority every single day. He has authority by virtue of his office. He knows that when he says, go and fetch that person will be fetched. He knows if he says, go build that road will be built. And to the standards that he sets, there's just no question. That's how it worked in Rome. You didn't buck authority. So as we begin this long season of Pentecost, and we begin this long season in which we take time to reflect on all the things that have happened during Advent and Christmas and Epiphany and Lent and Easter, culminating in the giving of the Holy Spirit to be our companion, maybe this is a good place to start. To whom do you give authority? Who gets to guide you in your decision-making processes? How do you decide to whom to give authority? Do you really give it? If you find a commandment somewhere, do you follow it? Do you explore it? Do you question it? How do you grapple with all the people who would love to be an authority in your life? Love to tell you what's right and wrong and good and bad. The political season comes to mind immediately. To whom do you give authority? And how do you make that decision? We have the Holy Spirit available. We live in the grace of God.